What's up, sons? It's Blind Rod with Cybotech once again, and I'm testing out a new lav mic for the kind of vlog styles that you saw on the first episode of building a server mining pool, a mining pool server. This is going to be episode 2. We're going to talk about some of the things we had to do to get the servers up and running from their previous state of being Google search appliances, what OS we went with, and of course some of the other options and features we installed to get to the point to where we can actually start spinning up the pool. So stick around. Welcome back. So this is a little different. The servers are now on site, meaning that we don't currently have them here for you guys to take a look at. If you're curious, you can check out the previous vlog and excuse the poor audio quality slash, of course, the blurred out image in the beginning. I do apologize for that. If you skip later into the video, we did have some good focus on the servers themselves, so you're good there. Essentially, we have two Dell PowerEdge 720XDs that have been, were Google search appliances that we are now repurposing for mining pool servers. We wanted to put them in HA failover, however, we don't have an MSA or a mass storage array, otherwise known as that. But usually we would have like an MSA, for an example, and have direct connect and then run failover that way. But because we don't have that option for this server, we essentially are going to have to use VirtualSAN, which I mentioned in the previous video. But first we had to get the servers up and running. And that's a little bit more difficult when you're talking about repurposing a Google search appliance. While on the previous generations, the 710s, you could just flash the BIOS password with the pins on the motherboard. This one, you can't do that because Google disabled those pins on the BIOS. So it is a custom Google BIOS, and it does come password protected with a password that we're unable to obtain or flash. So how did I get these up and running with the Dell BIOS? It was a lot of troubleshooting, and we are actually doing a write-up because there isn't really any information on how to do it on the web. If you go to the official Google repurpose page, it says to call them and you have to have a valid DRAC license. While we do have a valid Dell Express DRAC license on these servers, we don't have the full license, which would allow the remote access to the BIOS for Google to remote in and make the changes. So we could either spend $500 per server to obtain those licenses, or we could find another way around it. If you look near the pins for the BIOS password reset, there's actually another set of pins for NVRAM. And while the USB boot and Pixie boot and all other boot options other than the hard drive with the OS on it are grayed out and not applied for these servers, if you flash the NVRAM, I found that you unlocked Pixie boot as a default boot option that would happen once it saw nothing on the drives. So the first step here is to go into the configuration utility with Control R on Dell's and wipe the RAID out and then reinitialize the RAID so it removes all the files that were previously on there for the original operating system. Once you do this, it'll fail to boot and go to the next boot device. Now, if you don't flash with the RAM, or you can also pull the CMOS battery, however you want to do it, but if you don't flash that, then you won't have the option for Pixie boot as a default. So the next step is to go ahead and move those pins and flash the board, which for some reason on these unlocks Pixie boot. It happened for both of the Dells we have here, so I'm pretty sure this is going to translate to anybody else that has a 720XD Google search appliance that they want to repurpose. Unfortunately, at my house, and the reason this isn't all videotape, I don't really have a Pixie boot environment. Now, while we can spin that up, it was just gonna take some time. And at my work, I was able to go ahead and use the Pixie environment that I actually set up there a while back. And it's actually a WDS server. And to basically Pixie boot, all I had to do was plug it in and it defaulted to the Pixie boot, and then it brought me into a Windows PE environment. So the WDS and Microsoft Development Toolkit, MDT, work hand in hand to deploy Windows operating systems to various devices on the network. And what I was essentially just wanting to use it for was the pre-boot PE environment for Windows to go ahead and open a command prompt. So once I was able to open the command prompt, I would be able to, you know, execute any executables that I had on local storage, etc. So I prepped the USB stick by going onto the internet, typing in the service tag at the Dell support website, and grabbing the latest Dell BIOS for the 720 XDs, and then placing it on the USB drive. I renamed it BIOS.exe to make it easy. And then once plugged in, I was able to change directories to the USB stick and execute the BIOS flash. So once I executed the BIOS flash, it took off and started running and wiped out the old Google search appliance BIOS, and we were good to go. But the BIOS password was still set. The thing it did unlock, however, was the BIOS reset pins. So I was able to actually use those to now reset the BIOS password and be able to get into the BIOS, rebuild my RAIDs, reset the settings, because Google does put them in performance mode, so the fans are loud as hell. We turned those down and we set everything back to stock, and then we installed the OS. The operating system we went with was Hyper-V. The reason we didn't go with VMware ESXi was because if we wanted to unlock the features for vSAN, we would have to pay some money, of course, to VMware for the features. So we didn't want to do that. The other thing you would have to do if you went with ESXi is you would actually have to, with the software we chose to use, which I'll talk about here in a second, we would have to have two valid Windows servers on both of the hosts to manage the virtual SAN. The virtual SAN we decided to go with was Starwind, but like I said, we'll talk about that in a second. So all we did essentially is, if you guys remember, we had the 100 terabyte SSD. We had the 100 gigabyte Dell SSDs that we put the operating system on, Hyper-V. The only downside with Hyper-V over ESXi here in this case, that one of the glaring issues is you can't run Hyper-V from a USB drive. And typically what I do is put an internal USB drive in and then load it. So unfortunately, this is gonna take up our solid state drives, just the Hyper-V here and all by itself is going to do that. We loaded Hyper-V, like I said, on both the hosts. You can use Hyper-V 2016 headless for free, and I'll leave a link in the description if you guys are interested in playing around with it. Once we did that, we spun up a CMC, a central management console, essentially with Windows Server 2016 on it, to manage what will now be our vSAN software, which is going to be, like I mentioned before, Starwind. Now I'll leave a link for Starwind in the description below, and you can use their vSAN service, which is a virtual SAN storage array, and you can basically put, essentially the way it works is on both hosts, you specify the same virtual disks on each host. So with one NIC between the two servers direct connected, you synchronize with this software the two virtual disks. And so once those are synchronized, you need to surface them to the Hyper-V software. So this software gives you another iSCSI to connect to that then surfaces that storage to the actual Hyper-V software, to the manager in the console, so that the host sees both of these disks for data stores and they're synced. So what happens then is you just load the OS or whatever virtual machine you want to on that, and then it's syncing between both the hosts. And what this does is if one host fails, the other host just runs as normal and you're good to go. It's failover. So if we have one host die here, your coins aren't gonna go anywhere. You're gonna still be mining, and nothing appears to be broken for you all. So that's what we're using it for. If you guys are interested, like I said, I'll leave it in the description below. Now, to mention everything else, there's actually gonna be three NICs that you need. You need one for synchronization. You need one to surface the storage, which means showing that storage to the hosts themselves as available storage. And then you need a third one for the heartbeat. And the heartbeat is just monitoring which server's up and which server's down. So, you know, if it loses heartbeat to one server, it'll push the load off to the other server. So that's what, how those all function. I'll try to go into more detail over the configuration once everything's set up in the new location that we have them headed out to. So basically they're gonna get out there, they'll get booted up, I'll get access to them remotely, and then we'll do a full configuration, a full configuration overview of the servers and how we have them set up there and how you can create virtual machines for building coins, essentially, is what we'll do there. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. It's a quick update. And I also wanted to go ahead and go over some testing for, of course, fixing some of the focus settings on this camera, because I'm not a super professional camera guy. I'm learning on YouTube as I go. And I also wanted to check out the audio here. Don't forget to hit like, comment, and subscribe down below. If you want to support us right now, we still do have a cloud version of the Sumo Pool that is up. You'll notice that we have a wait page on the Zcash pool right now. So the only pool that we currently are leaving up is Sumo Pool. Everything else is getting moved over to these servers. And I'm very excited to do it all. We're also working on a front-end GUI that will display all the coins and all of that. So it's a big project. And the reason I'm having videos like this out as opposed to my normal information is because I can only share with you guys what I'm currently working on. As I have a day job and everything else, whatever consumes my time in the after hours is kind of what you guys are gonna see. So whether that is sometimes gaming like you guys see, or sometimes, you know, spinning up these servers, that's just what I can share with you all. But I still wanna make sure you guys know I'm here and working on stuff, and so that you know you can look forward to more mining content down the road. I'll see you next Tuesday.